Universal Broadcasting Network. Tune in at ubnradio.com.
Welcome to Both Sides Now, featuring the unconventional duo, Dr. Shirley and medium Kelly White.
Two perspectives, one world.
This is Both Sides Now.
Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to Both Sides Now. I'm Dr. Shirley.
And I'm medium Kelly White.
And as usual, John, our wonderful
ladies,
producer's here.
Happy to be here with you.
Thank you so much. We're happy to have you here with us. We couldn't do it without you, right, Kel?
Oh, no way.
Totally.
Oh.
So we want to make a few announcements right at the beginning of the show. We're going to let you know that we are announcing the winner of the, what is it, John?
So we did a, we asked folks to please share the video from the crystal show when we talked about all about crystals. So we're asking them to stay tuned because we're going to do the drawing for the winner of that free 30-minute giveaway that we did with a session with Kelly. So it's a 30-minute session that Kelly will be providing for anybody who shared the video, the crystal show video. So we'll be spinning the wheel and giving away that winner today.
We took all the names of people who shared that video and John put them in a wheel, kind of like, what is it, Wheel of Fortune?
Like a Wheel of Fortune,
and are they going to be able to see that?
Yeah, they will.
Okay, so then we're going to spin the wheel and whatever name comes on, then Kelly will give a free 30-minute reading. So thank you so much for participating in that. We really appreciate it.
And we do love it when you share because it helps us build our audience and get the message out there. So please continue to hit the share button on this Facebook video that you're watching right now.
Yeah. And thank you so much for doing that. And also follow us on Facebook and Twitter. And we also have Instagram now.
We do.
Much to my, I don't know, dismay.
I don't know how to use it, but we have it.
I know. I feel so old and ancient.
God.
And the worst thing is I'm not even interested. Well, I'm not interested in finding out how to use it.
Oh, I thought you were going to teach me tonight, actually.
Well, I'll teach you to see how to look at the Instagram. And it's not because I don't want to connect with people. I really do. But, it's hard to kind of get in with the times when you're old school. And my brain kind of works when I'm used to something. I kind of stick with it, you know. So I promise, because I love everyone who listens to the show and really supports us. Because, I mean, what we want to do is just kind of open up people's thinking. And we really appreciate you supporting us in that. So I vow to learn how to use, I do know Facebook, that one I've gotten used to. Twitter, a little bit, but Instagram I haven't used at all, and I'm going to start using that too, and I'll show you how to use it too.
Super.
Okay. So
we have quite a show tonight, actually. Mm-hmm. Talk about opening up everybody's mind.
Yeah.
You know, we really have a very serious topic tonight.
Yeah.
How this all came about is we always ask our listeners if they would like to, you know, have a subject for us to talk about.
Yeah.
And we have this wonderful listener, Angela, who actually wrote to us and gave us a topic. And she gave me permission. And what I'd like to do from the beginning, Shirley, is dedicate this show to her beloved sister, Krista.
Yeah, we dedicate the show to Krista.
Yes.
And thank you for reaching out to us and suggesting that we talk about this topic. It's such an important topic.
It's such an important topic. Yeah. And this topic tonight is about the survivors of suicide, the people that are left behind. Shirley and I will do a show on suicide a couple of weeks, probably, if you think.
Yeah, in a couple of weeks, kind of how to recognize someone that may be suicidal and what, what is it about people that want to commit suicide? And we're going to touch a little bit upon it tonight, but tonight is really dedicated to the survivors, to people who have dealt with someone, either a close friend or a family member who has committed suicide. We want to acknowledge those people because it's a very hard thing to deal with and to be left with.
It's very difficult. Yeah. And what I wanted to start off with was Angela was so graceful and grateful. I mean, I should say I'm so grateful to her, but she was so wonderful to send me an email. We spoke on the phone a couple of times, and she sent me an email. And Angela, I know your family and you are listening out there. I really encourage you to start a blog or write a book. She's a wonderful writer. And I just wanted to read a few things from her email that she said that I thought was so touching. Again, her beloved sister committed suicide about a year ago and left behind a daughter, who I believe is now 17, and a son who was 12 or 13. And that's rough. And so what Angela went through was, she said, I want people to know that that you go through this to know that they're not alone and that you don't have to be alone or suffer in silence. She said that you will find others that are literally going through the exact same thing, and it's impossible to believe in the beginning. But she said it takes the strength of another survivor to lift up another. And I thought that was
beautiful.
And probably very correct.
Absolutely.
To know that somebody else has gone through what you've gone through. And by the way, and we will talk about this, there's so many different ways of how suicide plays out. It's not like when I was in grad school, we were taught that it's, you know, it's against somebody. But, and we'll talk about this in our next show. But
yeah.
There's so many ways. It's not necessarily that.
Yeah, it's not necessarily a hostile act.
Right. I mean,
yeah.
Yeah.
It can be, of
course.
And we'll get more into that. But it's tough for those that are
left behind.
And we'll talk about that. I thought, you know, maybe to start the show off, if you can pick a Power of Love card to start us off.
Well, let me just finish this.
Because then we can
do that too. But
yeah.
Angela continues and says, it's hard to forgive yourself for not knowing what you did not know. I mean, once it's already said and done and you go back and you have a little more time, you can see the bigger picture of the person's life. So she said because her sister had given this portrayal that everything was fine and she didn't need anything, when in reality she was sinking and she was taking her kids with it. One of the things that helped her was to continue to write an ongoing letter to her sister, even though her sister has passed, to write an ongoing letter to her about what she's feeling and what she's dreamt about and her anger and her love and her deep sorrows, and to tell her how the kids are doing. So another thing she said, it says, almost a year after, and it feels like I'm driving through life with the parking brake on. I am back in life. It's not impossible, but it's just difficult to get anywhere or find motivation to do anything. I have to work 10 times harder in order to get anything done. The motivation, exhaustion, and anxiety are a big hill to climb. And then she says, here are a few things people can do if you are ever faced with the same situation. Take help from others. Don't try to be strong. If someone says they want to help, just let them and start giving them a list of things to help with. And whether that is helping with an obituary or standing at the funeral home while you attempt to make decisions, somebody to bring in meals, go grocery shopping, do a load of laundry, pack up a home of the deceased, ask anybody, rehoming pets. And it will make a difference for both people. For everybody, it would make a difference.
Yeah.
Because people don't know how to respond. They don't know what to do. But if you can always ask for help, right?
And really, you know, and again, especially for the avoidant attachments out there like me, who the do-it-yourself person, no, I'm okay, mm-hmm. to really kind of take a moment to really notice what your needs are. And you don't have to call them needs if you don't want to, if that's too activating. But to allow people to help.
Yeah, especially during this time, because this is a different type of grief than we have discussed.
Yeah.
This kind of grief is the kind that is, you want to, like, why did this happen? People start to look for a reason.
Yeah,
we'll
get
this
into
happen?
That yeah, in a moment.
Yeah, we'll definitely look through this. And then she continues and says, people going through this need to be kind and patient with themselves. While going through this ongoing process, they need to keep seeking, connecting, and finding hope wherever they can. And they need to do that daily. And I love what she has to say about this.
Yeah.
Because everything, step by step, you start to move on.
Yeah, taking tiny little steps.
Tiny little steps.
One at a time, one in front of the mm-hmm. other.
And for people out there, listen. That's really the most important thing, too, is to listen to the other person. If they are able to talk and if they're ready to discuss it.
Yeah.
To really just be an ear for them.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not so much what you do. It's just to be there.
Yeah, just
you know?
To,
and
just
I
to be
found,
there.
And again, I want to pick a card before we even get started, but I found that the most helpful question to someone who's going through any kind of grief or any kind of, you know, issue is, how can I help?
Yeah, how can
and
I help?
And let me tell you, that just kind of...
Even for an avoidant,
nothing.
Huh?
Yeah. Even for an avoidant. Yeah. I'll never forget a friend of mine I was going through. I can't remember what it was. Certainly wasn't, you know, grieving the death of someone. But I was going through a stressful time. And he just looked at me and said, "How can I help?" And it was like, it was, and there was nothing he can do, but that question alone.
Well, it opens it up.
Well, because it isn't trying to do it for me or trying to fix it for me. It wasn't like, well, you should do this or you should do that. It wasn't that. It was just, how can I help? And it was just such a, it's such a beautiful question when you're going through something so difficult.
Well, that's an interesting card. I pick loyalty. Your reliability demonstrates your loving sense of devotion and consistency of being. I think this goes to you, Angela, because you've been so incredibly loyal. And what an extraordinary soul you are. Really, I really think this is for you, honey.
Yeah.
So, but this is a very unique kind of grief. And we've done a lot of research on this.
And I think the reason why it's unique, you know, when someone passes of cancer or a debilitating, you know, a terminal illness or something, it makes sense. It doesn't feel good, but it makes sense. Mm-hmm. And I think from a neurological standpoint, the brain is primed to make sense of stuff. And that's how our species survived. I need to make sense so I can prepare for the future. And that way I can stay alive. And that part of the brain, which is the primitive part of the brain, hasn't changed since we existed on this earth. And in suicide, it's hard to make sense of it.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's kind of where these survivors are left with this kind of, question. And that questioning, when you can't make sense of it, it's not just for left brains. I mean, really, the brain works that way. Causes people to have that kind of uneasiness. You know, and then you look for blame. I should have found something.
Yeah,
I should have known it. I should. Mm-hmm. And so in order for the brain to make sense of something, it'll look for blame.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Very true. I mean, this is, sometimes death by suicide is a very violent situation, and it's certainly unexpected in most cases. And so survivors are going to have to figure out, while they're in shock, they're going to be asked to do all kinds of things, like possibly to visit the death scene. So that would be only if you could, but you don't have to. So there's all kinds of choices that are going to have to be made in a situation. But imagine these poor families that have to go through this.
Part of it is also within that is taking care of yourself. And if going to the death scene, if you can't do it, just simply say, "I can't."
Absolutely.
If you feel like you want to have that closure, to maybe hold,
And you're absolutely right. In fact, there's a fellow who wrote a book, and John, I'd love you to put this up as a resource. His name is Jack Jordan. He's a clinical psychologist, and he's a co-author of After Suicide Loss, Coping with Your Grief. And Shirley, he says exactly what you just said. I mean, you don't need to add any more trauma, and maybe somebody can do that for you. But on some people, it might give them closure.
Right.
But on some people, it might play it over and over and over. And then we're looking at PTSD.
Right. Right.
Which is very common in a situation where there has been a suicide.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's important. And no, we didn't announce this, but we will be taking your calls. Mm-hmm. And what's the number, John, to call?
The number today is 323-649-8268. Again, 323-649-8268.
And you can also go on the chat, right? And how do people
exactly?
Go on the chat?
So they can go. So we don't see the Facebook comments until after the show because it's a limitation that we have with Facebook. But you can go to UBN Radio Channel 2 and click there, and then log in with your social media handle, and we will see the comments in the chat room, and we'll do our best to interject throughout the show. And I did see one comment come in right before, and that was from Debbie. She's saying, "You two amaze me more each week. Aww. Together, what a beautiful, powerful, and blessed force for everyone to watch. I love you both. So true with that letter. People need to reach out to others in their time of need, be a shoulder to cry on, and be there for them."
Right on. Oh, thank you, Debbie.
Thank
See, Angela,
you, Debbie.
More support.
Yeah.
More support.
Yeah.
Because that's what this topic needs.
Oh, absolutely.
You can't be afraid of this topic.
There is nothing like someone being able to, feeling empathy from someone, not only because they're empathic, but from someone that went through the same thing.
Right.
It just adds that deeper layer that someone really gets how you're feeling.
And that there's hope because that person survived. One of the things that Angela talked to me about, which I thought was so amazing, is she knows somebody that this happened to as well. And every time she gets to see this person, it brings her hope, because this other person had been 7 years, and look at this person is doing what he needs to do. And that's really what is required.
Yeah.
Now, of
yeah.
course, as a medium and as a therapist, as a psychologist, we have tremendous compassion for this.
Oh, yeah.
And
oh,
so
yeah.
What is really necessary is compassion for this, whether you can understand it or not, just to be open and loving and kind and listening.
And it's
and with no judgment, no judgment. Anybody's out there listening, no frigging judgment.
I was just going to say that it's easy to judge.
Oh, please.
You know?
Ridiculous.
How could they? The selfishness, leaving kids behind and stuff. And one thing that I would urge, and this is, you know, what I've certainly learned from you, but just to know that everyone's on their own journey. And so when you notice a judgment cross through your brain, because we are human, you know, to just notice it and say, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to judge, you know, because who knows? It's really that kind of thing where you need to walk into someone's shoes before you really know what's going on. Because a lot of times, as we talked at the beginning, suicide, and especially when you and I went to school, it was more about a hostile act, you know, a kind of a fuck you to someone. And sometimes it is. I mean, I've had people whose significant other committed suicide on their mother's birthday kind of thing. And
that could possibly be big.
But it's also, a lot of times, suicide is not necessarily to end life, but to end the pain.
Yes.
You know, these people are in tremendous pain and they don't know how to get out. And it feels like the only way to get out is just to end it. And that, how can we not understand that or have empathy for that?
And their container can only contain so much.
Yeah.
Their container is full of this intense emotion. Yeah. And sometimes you can let the energy out a little bit, but especially if there's been a mental illness, which is in a huge population for committing suicide. And if somebody is in such deep depression, it's even with medication, sometimes it's their container is full and they just are in too much pain, as you just said.
I heard of someone who at 25 was diagnosed with schizophrenia and decided, I don't want to go through this, and committed suicide because they didn't want to go through it. You know, bipolar disorder is one that has a high incidence of suicide because of the high ups and the low lows, and not feeling like, you know, this sense of hopelessness is a big one when people commit suicide. I mean, imagine that you feel like that's your only way out of this incredible pain or
terrible pain.
Or sense of hopelessness. I can't get out of my situation. Okay. So it's so important to have empathy and not judgment for it. And again, if the thought comes through your mind that it's just a thought, that's okay. But then you can replace it with, you know, with.
But, and another part of this is, so when the person commits suicide, the families that remain, the first thought usually is, what could I have done? Could I have done something differently?
That's the brain trying to make sense.
I'm telling you, and it goes over and over and over, and they will replay it over and over.
So when you notice your brain doing that, just notice, okay, that's my primitive brain needing to make sense of it. And you can even go a step further and go, because that's how our species survived. And that's okay, but I don't need to make sense. Some things don't make sense, and it's okay. And suicide made sense for the person who committed suicide. And it's nothing that I did or I could have done.
Or sometimes they're so out of their mind that they truly can't think any way else out.
Yeah, or sometimes it's you know, they're hallucinating and believe that someone told them to jump off the bridge kind of thing. So
that goes under the mental illness part of it.
Exactly. So we don't know. And we don't, and sometimes feel so, you know, for the people where it is a hostile kind of, you know, a fuck you kind of, for people who, you know, didn't feel like they can tell somebody, wow, what you're doing is hurting me, or, you know, usually it's against a parent sometimes.
Or a husband or a wife.
Yes. So to understand that they just felt trapped in their own mind for whatever reason. So again, it's trying to understand it and not coming from judgment. And for the survivors, there is a stigma also.
Well, I just wanted to talk about the stigma, the shame, and the isolation.
Yeah, please.
Because the suicide can isolate survivors from their community and even from their family members. And also, some religions specifically condemn it as a sin. So survivors then have a really understandably reluctant, possibly, to disclose this information. I mean, it's not as simple. It's complicated grief. It's not like my sister died of cancer. My sister died of...
Well, someone says that, there's an immediate empathy. Right. Oh, you know, I'm so sorry. Mm-hmm. Even if you haven't suffered through it yourself. But with suicide, it's almost like a judgment. Oh, yeah, what didn't you do to stop that person from committing suicide? So,
and so Shirley, what happens is sometimes this decision keeps the suicide a secret, and particularly in a family, and particularly relatives can go blame one another. Mm-hmm. And when that happens, that actually can continue in the generations of families.
Mm, yeah.
As so a secret.
It's important for you yourself to understand that it's nothing that you could have done. It's the person on their own journey, and find people that are going to be supportive. So if you have family members that you know are judgmental, then don't try and have a conversation with them. I mean, I would really avoid talking to them if they're going to be judgmental, and find a support group or find friends or that are empathic.
Yeah, absolutely. Or a psychotherapist or a psychologist.
Oh, absolutely.
Because you really need your own time, because there's very little work done on families in suicide counseling together, because often there might be one blame to the other one.
Yeah.
So it's probably maybe best, depending on the family, to do one, you know, by yourself. But there's a lot of mixed emotions, because after a homicide, you know, survivors can direct their anger at their perpetrator. But in a suicide, the victim is the perpetrator. So it's kind of a bewildering clash of emotions.
Right. You know? Well, there's a wonderful article in Psychology Today, which we're going to post on our Facebook after the show, that says, you know, it would strange that you would never blame a family member for a loved one's cancer or Alzheimer's disease that caused their death, but society continues to cast a shadow on a loved one's suicide. And so, and that unfortunately is so true. So find a group that's supportive, even if it's outside of your family. If your family can't be supportive either because they're so religious, they can't see past, you know, the religious kind of stigma on it, find a supportive, and if it's not a live supportive group where you go to it, there's so many resources online where you can at least find that kind of support online of people who understand, who don't have that stigma and can be there to support you.
There's a great one called Survivors of Suicide, and I'm not sure if that's .com. I'm not sure, John, but we'll find that to put that up. Because
John is
they have
busy looking it up to share that
help with that.
Yeah.
And the other thing that comes up is the need for a reason. What if those kind of questions start to come up? What if we had gone to the doctor sooner? What if we had done this? What if we had done that? And you know, survivors tend to greatly overestimate their own contributing role and their ability to affect the outcome.
Well, that is so true, because in my experience, if someone is going to do it, they're not going to tell anybody. So you will not find out.
So true.
It's people who are asking for help that will maybe call you and say, you know, I'm feeling suicidal, and that's certain someone that you can help, or the people that call the suicide hotline. But if someone is serious about committing suicide, they won't tell anybody, and they will actually try and hide it from people and then just do it. Mm-hmm. So there truly is nothing that you can do, unless, of course, someone comes up to you and says, I'm feeling suicidal, and you don't do anything about that, or you say, you know, well, why are you coming to me, you know, kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, if someone's serious about doing it, they're going to do it. So when you notice yourself blaming yourself, notice that, because the thought's already there, but then have self-compassion. Talk to yourself through, like you would tell a friend. I mean, if a friend came up to you and said, you know, I feel guilty because I should have done something because my, you know, so-and-so committed suicide, you wouldn't say, yeah, you should have. So be curious as to why you would say that to yourself, and treat yourself in the same way that, and advise yourself or talk to yourself the same way that you would talk to a friend or a family member.
Right, absolutely. Because suicide can shatter all the things that you take for granted about yourself and your relationships and your whole world.
Yeah.
And survivors need to conduct a psychological autopsy, finding out as much as they can about the circumstances and factors that lead up to the suicide in order to develop a narrative that makes sense to them.
Well, that's the part of making sense.
That's the part of making sense.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And if you feel that that's necessary, then do so. Otherwise, you know, just kind of be with what is and try to accept what is. You know, for those who are around someone that survived a suicide, don't be afraid to acknowledge the death. Mm-hmm. Ask the survivor, like we said before, how they can help. Encourage openness. Encourage people to talk about it. And please, 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 whatever you do, do not give these kind of blanket platitudes like, at least they're not in pain anymore. Or that, I mean, that
gets to you, huh?
Irks me because it's so, because you feel like you're not heard. Just hear me out. Just say, wow, that sucks. I'm sorry you're going through that. What can I do to help? Those things are helpful, not, well, at least they're not in pain, or they had some great years, or...
Oh, my God, Shirley, that's terrible.
Oh, my God. I've heard people say that. Oh.
I don't want to hear that about an 85-year-old. Right? I don't want to hear it.
Well, because the truth is, people, and I don't blame those people, they don't know what to say. Mm-hmm. Even in a regular, passing of someone who died of a terminal cancer or a terminal disease, you really don't know what to say. And sometimes less is more. Sometimes your presence, sometimes just sitting with the person, even if the person isn't talking, the fact that you're there, sharing, holding that space for someone is huge.
And the other thing that is a huge risk for survivors is that people who've recently lost someone to suicide, they are at increased risk of thinking about it. Mm-hmm. And so what I do as a therapist or as a medium, if the person that comes in to see me and I immediately find out that there's been a suicide, I almost stop the whole session and just look right at the person, whether I'm on Skype or if I'm on the phone or wherever I am in my office, and I say, are you suicidal? Do you know how often I get yes? Oh, I would say 100% of the times.
Yeah. Well, it's almost like when someone that you know, whether it's a family member or friend, commits suicide, it almost adds that to the survivor as an option.
Yeah, it's an option. That's right? Exactly right.
And it's not that we don't know about suicide, being human and an adult, you've heard of it. But when someone close to us does it, it almost opens that up as an option. That's why many times you hear about kind of generational suicide where a grandmother did it and then a mother did it and then the daughter, it's it.
Right.
So that's something also to be aware of. And if you're the friend of someone who did it, you can ask them directly, do you feel suicidal?
Right.
Let me be your pillar right now. Let me be here for you. And for the person who is surviving a suicide, let people in. Don't isolate. Take some time for yourself, absolutely, because I know that's important. But also in the day, schedule time to be with people. Do not isolate because that is not healthy.
Yeah,
it's not. It's not going to help you. Make connections. Give yourself permission to feel what you're feeling and. Be with someone who can be completely supportive regardless of what comes out of your mouth.
Oh, absolutely.
Right? Yeah.
And this goes along with if you can get professional help.
Absolutely.
Because that is only going to aid you, actually. Because it's been my experience, and I happen to work with this population a lot of survivors that come to see me, because as a medium, they're coming to me about their loved one who's killed themselves. And... I always, first I want to make sure that person that I'm with, the living person, is the survivor, is still going to be with us. And I just want to say this. What I've always noticed is that this person on the other side is sorry about what happened. Mm-hmm. They didn't know any of, they couldn't do anything else. That's really how they left. They get help on the other side. So if I can go into that, they get help on the other side. They you're never alone, even in a suicide. So sometimes people will ask me that because it could be all of a sudden. But the call, before somebody passes away, the call goes out to the universe 6 to 8 weeks before. And so even though we have free will here, and that we do have free will here, and in a free will situation, we could do it or not do it, the universe is prepared. So there always is a relative on the other side, a soul, their spirit guide is there to greet them, to take them. So you don't need to worry about that. They're never alone.
Yeah. Yeah. John, I think you mentioned that we have a caller.
Yes, we do. We have several callers lined up. So.
Should we take calls?
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's go ahead and start here with area code 727. I believe this is Diane. Diane, are you there with us?
Yes, I am.
Hi, Diane.
Hi, Diane. Thank you for calling.
Thank you for calling during this especially difficult topic.
Oh, well, thank you for taking my call.
Did you lose somebody to suicide?
I did not, but it is an interesting subject. I enjoyed listening to you tonight. I've learned a lot of things.
Thank you.
Oh, good. Well, how can we help you tonight?
Yeah, my question is actually a bit more on the opposite side. Just curious if I'm meant to have a soulmate on this earth side.
Oh, well, Diane, what's your birthday?
My birthday?
Mm-hmm.
June 20th, 88.
You know, so many people ask about a soulmate. That is one of our, probably our biggest constant questions about soulmates.
And first of all, we should probably explain what a soulmate is.
Yeah, well, I think that everybody comes in. A soulmate, what people think about a soulmate is that they are the one person that is going to be their other half. Is that about right, John?
Yes, exactly. Okay. A lot of people think that.
You're right.
Well, and I think that word is used to kind of signify that
many times. Yeah,
and
I think that's
the way, Diane, if I'm understanding you correctly, is just finding, you know, your other half, your companion, someone that you can share life with.
Yeah. And Diane, Diane, you do come in to find, to learn about relationships. Have they been difficult for you?
Yes, I would say so, but more for, because, I actually project myself, so I feel it hard to, because I can't love myself fully, you know, open up myself to others.
But you know how wise you are to know that, because if I was doing a reading for you, I would have actually gotten into that. That's one of the things that you actually need in this lifetime to work on. So how wise at a young age that you got that. I'm impressed.
Yeah.
Because now that you're aware of that, there's no telling where you can go, because you come in to learn about relationship. You must be very talented, too. And you have a mind. Do you have trouble sleeping?
So.
You must have trouble sleeping as well.
Yes, that's true. I'm a night owl.
Yeah, because you've got a mind that goes and goes and goes. But I love that you want to work on yourself. I mean, that is one of the areas that you came in this lifetime to explore. So will you have a soulmate? You bet. You bet you will. Sometimes I call them cellmates, so be careful what you wish for.
Yeah.
Well, in fact, I always call them cellmates.
I would suggest that because you have that awareness, you know, find a good therapist that can help guide you through so you can heal that. You know, the awareness is the first step. It's so interesting when people come in to see me, I kind of gauge where they're at. And if we have to, if they're aware like you are, Diane, then that kind of cuts out a lot of the work that we have to do, and we can really kind of start working on, you know, healing the wounds of what caused that, so you can then be open to live up to your potential in this lifetime. Many people who don't have that awareness, we have to start from there. So it's wonderful that you're aware. I would look for a really good therapist that can kind of give you the tools so you can heal those wounds and really kind of come out and be who you came here to be.
Absolutely.
And write. Thank you for that advice.
You're welcome. And Diane, I want you to write. You need to start writing.
Wow, it's amazing you said that.
Maybe write out the qualities that you're looking for.
Yeah, right. Yeah, well, you can certainly write out that. But I'm actually looking at a book or blog or something. You really need to write.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Do you see when I'll actually be able to jump over this hurdle and you see some becoming into my life?
Well, that's just it. Because you have a mind that works really well, you know, as Shirley said, go really start really, really working on yourself. And I only would want you to pick well. There's a lot of people that, you know, you could pick anybody. But you don't want to do that. You don't, and especially drugs and alcohol, you have to really stay away. Have people, you cannot pick people that do drugs or alcohol. And also, I know you want somebody that's extremely loyal, so you have to really look for that as well. Okay? Don't be afraid.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and there's a trick that one of my friends and teachers, Dr. Stan Tatkin, who's a couples therapist, says, you know, bring someone that you like sooner than later to meet your friends, because sometimes our friends can clue into something that we don't. We can find someone, oh my God, they're so wonderful, and our friends are like, ew, there's something wrong with that guy.
Right.
Because if we don't heal our wounds, we will choose someone that has the issues that we haven't healed with from our parents. And that's just the way it goes. Freud called it repetition compulsion. Yeah. So I didn't make that up. And I'm not the Debbie Downer here.
And I'm the cellmate.
Right. Exactly. The cellmate. So you will choose a cellmate if you haven't healed your wounds.
Exactly.
And because you are so aware, you are, I think, primed to just, it's going to be just a little tweak, but find someone good that can help you with that so you can actually find a soulmate and not a cellmate.
Yeah, because essentially soulmates are more of mirrors in relationships. They mirror the behavior that you need to look at, whether that be positive or negative.
Exactly, exactly. Right. So
you're here to learn. So thanks for calling.
Yeah, thank you so much for calling, Diane.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
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 It's so true, though. Yeah. You know, cellmate versus
soulmate.
All
the time.
All the time.
I mean, how many times they say, you know, it's just like my mother, just like my father. And it's not to put blame on parents. It really isn't. But the first 5 years of our life, you know, our brain is developing, and that's what kind of sets the tone. And who are we mostly with?
Well, and here's another thing what happens is when you're really, really, really wanting to meet somebody, and then you meet somebody, you project everything onto them.
Oh,
so please.
They become, if you had a difficult relationship with your parents, they become the parent that you need to protect yourself from. You know, the parent that was too critical, or the parent that was, you know. And it could be siblings, too.
Right, but you also project that love thing that goes out. Like
idealism, right?
Idealism. Yeah. Oh, look, this person is so perfect for me. He does this or she does this and blah, blah, blah. You know, like 3 months later, that's
then the true colors start showing.
Yeah, and you're like, what?
It takes about
6 to 9 months
for true colors to come out. Yeah.
But if you're really aware and you just don't drink all the Kool-Aid, you'll be okay.
Yeah. I just saw something on CNN about the 70s, and they talked about Jim Jones and the Kool-Aid and drinking the Kool-Aid.
Oh, you're kidding.
Yeah.
That's
where the expression came from, But not to get into, because we will do a show on relationships. Mm-hmm. I know we did a show recently on soulmates, but we'll do a show on love and relationships. But it's... Oh.
Yeah.
Hold on, I lost my train of thought. You were talking about...
Kool-Aid.
Yeah.
That's what I was
But the
talking
thing
about.
Is that, you know, we'll get back to the topic at hand. I know that a lot of times when these calls come in, we're really not sure what they're going to ask about, but we're here to pretty much address whatever your issue is, so from a spiritual and psychological perspective. But I do believe our next caller is about suicide, so let's move on to area code 520. 520, you're on the line. Can we have your name, please, and where you're calling from?
This is Olivia, and I'm calling from Arizona.
Olivia?
Hi, Olivia. How can we help you?
Hi. Thank you for calling.
I have a couple of questions because it has to do with a family member that committed suicide and left a lot of questions for the kids, you know, the adult children.
Yeah.
And one of the things is it was like there was no clue that it was even going to happen, the suicide. And it seems like it was just an abrupt decision by the man to do that. I mean, is there anything we could have, his adult kids could have looked for that would have given them a hint that
you know, it's
things
really,
weren't
it's
going
very
right?
interesting. Was he in his late 50s or 60s?
Yeah, yes, he was close to 60.
Yeah. So,
he's 58.
Yeah, so, I was getting 59 actually, but it's so interesting that what happens. Well, a few things. Men particularly don't talk about their emotions, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, they just don't. They just kind of bottle it all up, and they go inward instead of going to a therapist or talking about it or whatever. And especially men in their late 50s, 60s. And I'll tell you, another population that's very – it's the highest, I think, for suicide are the elderly. But we'll talk about that another time.
Yeah.
But from getting what I'm getting from him, and I'm getting, and I don't know. I lost a family member today, actually, whose name was Frank, and so I keep hearing the name Frank in my head. If that's not his name, is it this man?
No, his name is Michael or Mike.
Okay. I got to write that Frank down for me because I'll have to deal with that later because he keeps trying to pop in, I think.
Right. His name's Mike Marlowe.
Oh, okay. I think my sense with him is that I'm getting that he was just tired, and he looks broke, like financially broke.
Yes.
And that was causing him. Yeah, tell him that's it. And that he was very just like that's the only thought he could have. There was like no way out. Well,
for men, that brings a lot of
shame. Oh, a lot of shame with that.
A lot of shame with the finances, you know, when you can't support, you know, your family, much, you know, whether it's yourself or your family members, it brings a lot of shame for men.
Yeah, it does for men. And again, he did not know how to communicate it. He didn't know how to speak about it. He was embarrassed. He said to even ask his older children for money. He was embarrassed that it was a crisis with him. But he didn't let this out. He didn't want anybody to know. I think he had a couple of friends that had an idea. And also, I don't know if there was gambling, but he was trying to make money. He was very quickly trying to make money.
Oh, I see. Wow.
Yeah.
There was something.
Well, it just seemed like all of a sudden this happened, and there was no,
well,
he had an issue, you know. He had a ticket for drunk driving.
Okay.
But we thought maybe that was what was scaring him.
That wasn't the only thing. That wasn't the only thing. All right. Yeah. And I'm sorry for your friends or your family's loss on that. But
And please let the kids know, you know, like we said at the beginning of the show, when someone's going to do it, they're just going to do it. They're not going to clue anybody in. They're not going to talk about it. They're not going to say anything. If someone is determined to do it, they are going to do it, and they won't give off any clues. So it's important to let the kids know so they can take that burden off of themselves to think, I should have known or I should have done something. There is nothing to do because you can't do something about something you don't know about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right. It was a shock. They didn't even really have an understanding of this financial stuff either. It's just kind of been clues afterwards.
Yeah.
You know, that there was something going on with the finances.
And, yeah, that's what it was. And there was a lot of shame around it, and a lot of, what I'm getting is he was very agitated right before it happened. Like scared, agitated, not knowing how to handle it, not knowing what to do. And this, apparently, this was his, not just his go-to, but he had thought about this before. I don't know if somebody in his family had done it before. Like, somebody in his family. I don't think he was the first. Had committed suicide. Somebody. Oh. I don't get that it's just him in this family.
Oh, wow.
Was he?
See, they don't know about that.
Okay. Was he
one of his friends even, it could have been, but somebody, it's like that idea came into his head.
Gave him that idea, Was he kind of a very proud man?
Yes.
Yeah, that was
very proud.
Okay, so
had always worked. Yeah.
Okay, so that would make it even more difficult for someone like that to ask for help if they needed it, particularly from their kids, and that would bring a lot of shame, particularly if they were a very proud, you know, person. So it seems like that's what it was about.
And I just know this, everybody that's listening, that the people that do that, they do get help on the other side. Please remember that I'm saying that. If there was alcoholism or whatever, any type of anything, drugs, alcohol, just
maybe
anger,
just hitting
anything,
hard times.
Hitting hard times. They're going to get help for their soul. It's mind, body, and soul. And the soul, the body, you leave the body, but your soul goes, and your soul will get help for the trauma that went through in this lifetime.
It's like a rehabilitation hospital.
Exactly right.
Mm-hmm. So thank you so much for calling.
Well, that's good to know.
Yeah.
There's actually a beautiful movie that talks about that. If I want to, can I bring that up?
Yeah, of course.
Okay. So the movie's called Astral City, Astral City, and you can probably watch it on Amazon or Hulu. And it's all about life on the other side. And this particular character. Which I think is based on a true story, doesn't necessarily commit suicide, but he does things that pretty much put his life at risk, that he knows it's putting his life at risk. So it's a slow suicide.
That's true.
Yeah. So it's a very interesting movie about what happens. So when he gets on the other side, he has this time in the healing hospital where his soul is being rehabilitated so that he can move on throughout his life on the other side. It's very, it's a very powerful movie that's very comforting.
Yeah. Thanks, John.
Yeah.
Sure thing.
Could I ask one more question?
Okay.
Sure.
There, he had a, an adult son, but they never found him. They didn't know how to locate him or anything. Do you have any way of knowing where he would be? We don't know his name. We just know he was born in the Philippines.
Wow. Hmm. You know, I'm not...
And he'd be...
I don't know where he would
close
be.
Close to 40.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't have any idea. I'm not getting a hit on that. I'm sorry. I'm not good at that one.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. That's not my one of my things.
I thought I'd ask.
I'm glad you asked.
That's another issue.
Yeah, no, I'm glad you asked.
Yeah, that's another issue.
But thank you for calling.
Yeah, thank you so much for calling.
Thank you.
Have a good night.
Okay. Yeah, I don't think I would ever be able to work for a policeman or anything or that. I'm fun, not.
So Kelly's the suicide whisperer. She really does a lot with suicide after they cross over and helping the soul. Yeah, and
that's why this topic for me is so dear to my heart. And again, Angela, bravo, honey. Mm-hmm. Thank you
thank
for
you
bringing
so
that
much.
To us.
And we invite anyone who wants a certain topic for us to talk about to please reach out to us on Facebook. And let us know, and we're more than happy to talk about different topics.
And please share this video. This is very helpful information, I think, that will help a lot of people. So if you hit the share button, it'll end up in your feed, and then if anybody comments on it, it ends up on other people's feeds. So it's just a way of really passing it on and getting that message out there. So we appreciate it if you do that. Just hit the share button, and then go to Both Sides Now and hit the like button. You can keep in touch with us and let us know what's going on in your life. We have maybe time for one more call, then we need to wrap, and we'll do the drawing for the winner from the show. Okay, so area code 519. Is on the line. 519, is this Mary Lou?
Yes, it is.
Hi, Mary Lou.
Hello?
I love your name.
I'm surprised I got through. I can't believe it.
Glad.
Yeah, I've had two suicide tragedies in my life.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
My father and my son.
Oh, my goodness.
And I was just wondering if there would be any message at all from... either one of them. My father was a long time ago. He was 42. My son was 25. That was about almost 5 years ago.
Oh, first of all, let me just say I'm so sorry for your loss.
So
it's
sorry.
Interesting, Shirley, isn't it? We talk about families.
Yeah.
You know, again, somebody in the family. I mean, I wonder if I was picking up on you. That may have been.
Yeah. It's possible. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So your father...
In my son's case,
Let me just say a few things here. Your father and it looks like another gentleman was there to help with your son, but somebody else...
I've been told that by another psychic.
So there was like another male over there, and I'm not sure if that's your son's father or there was another man with him other than your father and another male, and it was very they're telling me it was very quick. Your son is you must have seen him. You can see him, right? Because he's telling me that there's been a lot of times he's just shown up in your kitchen, like just shown up. He's very
He's
just telling me that
really
energy.
Not sure.
And
I think it's just my imagination.
No, it's not your imagination. And he's talking about animals with cats, particularly cats. I'm not sure what he means by that.
He'd be talking about cats. Yeah. We had cats. He had cats.
Yeah, that's
his.
It was. He's okay because he's laughing about that. He's got a great sense of humor. He's very sorry for putting you and everybody, he said, through this. And also, was there a girlfriend around him?
No, he never had a girlfriend, a steady girlfriend that I know
of. Maybe it was a sadness about that, because it looks like...
I just wanted to say, as far as my son goes, he took an overdose. He called us. We got him to the hospital. He didn't die from the overdose. He died because they made mistakes at the hospital. So there was a lot of a lot of horrible things that went on. And I'm having a lot of a hard time dealing with it.
Oh, my God. Of course.
He didn't want to die. He wanted help, you know. Okay. And sadly, they made a couple of bad mistakes. He was in the hospital for 8 days and died actually from a pulmonary embolism, which they misdiagnosed. So it was just another part of it. So it's been very, very hard on me.
Of course.
But, I know...
First of all, let me give you this message. Can I tell you something, Mary Lou? He's sorry for everything that he put everybody through with this, okay? And he's telling me that he's very sorry about all of this. As you said, it was an accident. He didn't mean to do it in that particular case. He's telling me that he had suffered from depression. He's telling me that he didn't even know the words to communicate it. He says, looks like you tried to get him into counseling. He said you tried, and that he had an aversion to it. Like, I don't need that. I'll work it out. I'm smarter than that. I'll figure it out. He's actually smart.
Well, he was under psychiatric care, and I had taken him to do that.
Good, good.
Yes.
Because he's telling me, though, that I'm getting that he's very smart, too, that he was smart.
Oh, yeah. Very smart.
And that was you were always promoted that with him. Thank you. And also, he's telling me that thank you for you had special flowers there for him, and he's telling me thank you for that, and thank you for, it was really hard when you went into his room and his space. He's telling me how difficult that was for you, that you broke down, that was a horrific scene, he's telling me, horrific, when you had to go in there later on. It was horrible for you, and he's just...
I had to go and clean up his apartment.
He's telling me, that was the hardest for him as well, and it was how sorry he is. He never, ever imagined that could happen. He wants me to get that message out there that he even never knew that could happen. And he loves you, and he's telling me to make sure that you and everybody knows in this family you were always so kind to him. He's talking about your gentleness and kindness with him. Thank you. And he loves you.
I don't know, but...
He told me that you were, and he's telling me that he loves you.
We didn't see eye to eye a lot, but we did make up.
But he loves you. He loves you, Mary Lou.
I hope so.
Oh, he does. He does. He does. Pay attention to those dreams, because he's coming by. All right?
I hope so. That's the thing. I'm just never sure if it's him.
It's him.
I would not question yourself so much.
Not at all.
If you see something, or if you dream of him, or if something reminds you of him, then know that that's him.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Absolutely. Yeah. Oh, please.
All right.
Absolutely. He'll be active. All right. Please take care of yourself, too.
Okay.
All right. Thank you for calling.
Well, it's interesting that you were talking about how the survivors think of suicide, because that's something that crosses your mind a lot.
Yeah.
After you lose your child, especially.
Oh, my God. Especially, I can imagine.
But I have another child and three grandchildren.
Oh,
so because
thank
of
God.
Them, I think that's why I'm still here.
Well, we've always said that, right?
So try and be in the moment when you're with your other child, and particularly your grandchildren. Try and be in the moment with them, and really, you know, be in that moment in the here and now, and enjoy the time that you're spending with them. That will help.
I try to. It's difficult, I have to say, it's just very difficult to, you know, I've changed so much. I'm such a different person since it happened, and I feel that sometimes my other son and grandchildren suffer because of that, you know.
Yeah.
But I mean, I guess we just have to accept it and try to do the best we can, right?
Well, and part of it is accepting, you know, for you to accept it as well and not blame yourself.
Yeah. Mm-mm.
You know,
that's really hard to do.
I know it's really hard, and I'm not trying to make it sound like it's easy, but...
No. And I know he does not want that. He definitely does not want that.
So try to treat yourself with the same... Yeah. Treat yourself with the same love and compassion that you would treat someone else who came to you and maybe shared with you how they were feeling. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we don't understand why it's someone's time to go, and it's not easy. But to blame yourself is wasted energy. It really is an energy that you could be spending and enjoying, you know, opening yourself up to accept the love that you're getting from your grandkids and your other son.
But, you know, it's so interesting because this is really why we chose this topic, Mary Lou. I mean, this is the kind of grief that, you know, it just crushes your soul. Yeah. It just crushes your heart. Right? I mean, I'm sure that's what's going on.
Yeah, you got that
here.
Right.
I know.
There's nothing worse.
And there's nothing worse, actually. You're absolutely right. Yeah. Oh, I got chills on that. There is nothing worse. And so, but, you know, one day at a time, keep looking forward to seeing the grandkids. And you will be reunited with your son when it's your time, but it's not your time yet. And please, if you ever feel that it's that you want to leave, please, you know, contact help. Mm-hmm. Get a psychologist around or a therapist around or a good friend, okay?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I unfortunately have a lot of good friends.
Okay. Oh, I'm so glad to hear that.
Well, that points to who you are as a human being. People don't hang out with people that they don't like.
Of course.
So if you have a lot of good friends, that means that you're a pretty special person. And use that community to help you through the difficult times. Mm-hmm. You know, I invite anyone who's listening to post on Facebook and start a community of suicide survivors that way and just feel connected. That connection, all the research shows that feeling connected helps get you through things. Right. Don't isolate.
Well, I'm in a lot of groups with parents who have lost children,
I'm so
glad through
to hear
medical
that.
Harm and through suicide. And it is good therapy.
Yeah.
We talk to each other. We understand how each other feels, and you know, I find it helps me a lot.
It doesn't take away the pain, but it does help you, you know, in the moments where you feel the pain.
That's true.
Well, thank you so much for calling.
Thank you so much.
Been talking to you. It's interesting about the cats. It's kind of funny.
He loves that.
Yeah. My son did have a very good sense of humor.
He's a real funny clown.
He made everybody laugh.
He's
wonderful.
A good boy.
Yeah. Wonderful. Okay. All right. Have a good evening.
Great.
Thank you for calling.
Thank you, Mary Lou. Wow.
Okay. Well, sending so much.
I know. So much love out there. But Angela. Yeah. Bravo, you brave soul. Mm-hmm. And Mary Lou, you're a brave soul. Yes. Thank you for calling in.
I think everyone.
Everyone. Olivia, thank you. Mm-hmm. And Diane, thank you.
Yeah. So who is our winner tonight? Just transitioning a little bit from this very
thing. Right before we do that, you know, I was hearing really strongly, and I'm wondering, Kelly, how you relate to this. You know, even though people have crossed over, they're not tangibly, we cannot feel them, but maybe we can feel them in spirit, you know, with the chill or what have you. But to know that in those moments that she's playing with the kids, that he's there watching and participating.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
That was kept coming really strong for me.
Absolutely.
Was that not to think of the loss, but to know that he's still there right now in that moment.
Absolutely. That is true, Mary Lou, if you're listening. That's very true. That he would play with the kids and be there and around the families. And just because you can't physically see them, get out of your left brain, move to the right brain. Mm-hmm. Start to sense the energy. They love, spirit loves on the other side.
Yeah.
When you're happy and you have joy and you lighten up and you are able to begin your life, you know, over again. And remember, you will see them again when it's your time. Not before it's your time, but when it's your time.
Yeah. I just wanted to end on that note because that was coming really strong. And I was just like, even though they're not here physically, they're still here in spirit.
Oh,
and I know we hear that a lot, but if we really grasp what that means.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's a nice reminder.
Yeah.
Thank you, John.
Sure thing. All right. So we've got this wheel up on the screen. Everybody can see this wheel with all the names of the people who shared. So the ladies can't see that, but they will in the replay. So right now I'm going to spin the wheel and I'll let you know who's going to be the winner. Here
spin
we go.
I can hear it.
It's spinning. You're going to hear it when they pick it, too. It's going to get really loud. All right. So the winner is, Laura Parsons. Oh, Laura Parsons Rowe. So you are the winner
of
the free 30-minute session with Kelly.
Wonderful.
So congratulations. And that was for everybody who shared the Crystals show that we had aired
so
a couple
much,
weeks
Laura.
Back.
Mm-hmm. And tell Laura how she can reach me. She can send me an email on my Kelly,
yes.
KELLEE@kellywhite.com.
There you go. So KELLEE at kellywhite.com, spelled the same way, K-E-L-L-E-E-White.com. And you see the screen at the bottom, it has her name, Kelly White. So just because I know Kelly spells her name interestingly.
Well, my father's name was Lee.
Oh, okay.
Oh, and that's why it's Kelly.
He's a jazz musician. Come on.
Oh, cool.
I just wanted to be normal with a Y. That just was never going to happen in
never
my lifetime.
Happen, never going to happen.
That's funny. All right.
So congratulations on winning a 30-minute reading with Kel. You're going to love it. And thank you again for listening.
Thank you so much, everybody.
Yeah, we really appreciate you participating on the show.
Suggestions coming for show topics.
Please
we just had an amazing one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Next week, we're going to talk about mindfulness all the research behind mindfulness and how powerful it really is. And before we go, I wanted to talk a little bit about when you said write down your thoughts and write down, a letter to the person who has passed away.
That's Angela's suggestion,
And all the research shows that writing things, journaling, it's not just kind of that psych 101, journal, feel good. There is actually research behind it that if you journal, if you write things down, if you write a letter to someone in this case that we're talking about.
Well, and in Angela's case, I believe it's ongoing.
Exactly. Yeah. That does help. Mm-hmm. It does help to reduce the trauma, feelings that are left. So please do that.
I've got something to say on that. Also, as you're writing it, on the other side, they're reading it.
Yes.
Yeah. They're kind of over your
shoulder.
So
they're over your shoulder
right?
going, oh, dear. Yeah. And that's true.
Yeah.
They see it.
Yeah. And that's mentioned in that movie, Astral City.
Oh, is it?
Really?
So they see the prayers that come up and then they respond to the prayer. That's up on the screen for folks who are wondering what I was talking about earlier, that movie, Astral City. It's pretty amazing. Surely you're going to have to watch that.
I know. I'm going to this weekend.
You're
going to
love it.
Great.
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you for listening, everyone. We really appreciate it.
Take care.
Have a good night. Bye-bye.
You've been listening to Both Sides Now, featuring the unconventional duo Dr. Shirley and Kelly White.
Two perspectives, one world.